Second clap.
Clap, 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 clap your hands. Clap, 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 clap. Clap your hands. Voel ze stevig binnenkant. Skrik wakker.
For me, man, can't check. Well, anyway, so I'm looking at you anyway.
Anywhere.
Anywhere?
Yeah.
Okay, don't matter.
Pick up all eight angles.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Welcome, welcome, welcome yet to another show of Kap Vas and Explore with Mo. Today is going to be an exciting day while I'm sitting down with the man, the beast, the man himself, the mayor from Cape Town, Mr. Yuzriq. Are you my bro? Are you? Are you?
Nah, I'm good, bro, yourself.
Nah, I can't complain.
Pleasure being here, bro.
Yeah, see, welcome to actually for agreeing to be on my show.
No stress, my king. Yeah.
You know, it's always a privilege to have our people on a show like this, you know, because I feel like this is the only place that I think is going to be in Cape Town where our people can be ourselves.
100%,
you know what I mean?
Bro, and we need more platforms like this, you know, so to get the word out, they see what the people are doing on the streets, you know.
You know what always excites me about you when you talk, me bro, it's like, yeah, me bro, it's like, me bro, it's like, that's my tongue.
As we said, also, what is that? Born and raised in the Cape Flats, bro.
But where the ghetto style, there's no way you were born and bred like it, me bro, this is the way it is.
100%, bro.
And that's always the thing that I think, when I started following you on internet, That's a genuine thing that I picked up about you, my bro. You always keep it genetic, like yourself. And I think there was a few times, and we're going to get into it later on, where people always get a problem with how you speak and other, the swear words, you know, the P-L-E-S words.
It's a sensitive.
Oh, yeah. There's always a one or two people, I guess, you know, sensitive ones. But we're going to get into that later.
Yeah.
Let's start off where you we have started.
And look, I don't know how far you want to go back. Do you want to go to the starting of just the journey in media for me, or just like all the way back, bro?
I think in the media, because I think your personality show is already where it started, you know.
Okay,
what I mean?
No, so listen, I mean, I guess it was fun. I went to Belgrave, I formed there, I went to go study at CBUT.
Yeah.
So I went to go study journalism. My idea, if I was going to be a tourist, what's her name? I think the guys on tours. No, then what happened was, I just happened to have an opportunity after finishing studying journalism to write for a magazine, and then we just treasure magazine at the time, so I wrote for a magazine. But the whole idea, if I wasn't gonna do the tours, I would be a news anchor. Very clean, nothing like that.
No wonder where the name comes from, Mr. Meyer.
Next one, but I think reluctant for me, my sister just told me, you know what, a friend of mine was working at Bush Radio. See, if there's something, I said, I have a Bush Radio, but at the time, of course, this is maybe 6-7 years ago, and I'm like, niemand kan Bush Radio nie,
yeah.
Waar daar toe gaan.
Yeah.
But I was like, you know what, I'm finishing journalism, I want to jump, I'm going to try something.
Yeah.
Started there, worked behind the scenes for a while, I mean, because I guess like anyone, you must understand, this, I also want to say this, lots of the youngsters out there, this thing doesn't happen overnight.
It doesn't,
you need
it
to
doesn't.
Start from the ground up, and it will not be shining, glamorous in the beginning. Started at the back, you know, just learning the ropes behind the scenes. Worked for about 3 months, I think it was the... It could have been mid-Feb, actually. So mid-Feb was the first time I went on air at Bush Radio.
And if you can say this on air, what have you done before you actually went into Bush Radio?
Into Bush Radio? In the sense of what?
Like any work. Like were you working somewhere else?
I was working. I worked briefly with the IEC, with the electoral campaign. So basically, I was the media liaison to get between politicians. Yeah. And the media connecting them with the SABC. Because I was working with
them. Well, at least you had like a job where people are saying like you on a certain level. Like people are always surprised when I tell them, but you know what? When I was at school or after school, I used to work at PEP. I used to work with Penties, my bro. People don't want to believe it. They don't want to believe it. But you see, it is exactly what you're saying now. Yeah. You have to start somewhere to like also somewhere. Like work your way into something.
Into
you know
something,
what I mean?
Yeah.
And this might be. Assumption, but I think from what I've heard and what I've seen, I think you have started or you built Bush Radio where it is today.
Look, man, I there's as many people that's gonna say that, you know, and I never want to take all the credit for everything, things like that, but I feel like I've done a substantial amount of work to make the platform much bigger than what it normally was, because again, it was just a community radio station, it still is a community radio station.
Yeah, yeah,
I mean, nothing's changed, but I think. me in a sense being there, I think I've commercialized the platform in such to such an extent where people have even compared it to commercial radio. Like, no, Bush Radio, you know, when they say any other radio stations, they're going to mention Bush Radio.
Yeah.
And I felt like because I was at the center of a period where social media was booming and I actually got to grab the attention of all those people through doing the viral videos. Because I think I was doing videos before I got to Bush Radio. I had somewhat of a following even before I got to Bush Radio.
Yeah.
I'm like, this is like, Mal Young, what's my videos, Marky? Radio stars. But I see your muscle, man. But the people also don't understand, you need to know how to flip on and on off. When I'm on the radio, it flip up your radio, ni.
Of course, yeah. That's your personality.
If I'm doing this interview with you, the man sometimes, I was so bang over my book, I was like, Mr. Meyer, I got flip up his stage. Like, he has a loose cannon. Like, I think I'm very clear and concise about what exactly is I'm doing.
Yeah.
And how I need to navigate it, and what people that never understood, there's always been a method to the madness.
There's a sense of
I know how to do. So yes, no. So I mean, I brought that following I already had to Bush Radio.
Yeah.
And there were certain things I added into the show which made it, I think, quite huge. I don't know if you've listened.
So definitely.
As Hopstok Maandag, lekker yard namens op Maandag, Dinsdag, as hip hop Tuesday in the old school.
Oh yeah.
So, and then on Wednesdays, Wacky Wednesdays, Electro. And then on Thursdays, Throwback Thursdays, Rave, old school Rave. And Friday is Friday, Saturday. So this was never done before on South African radio, where you had a breakfast show that catered to every single genres. And I think I just capitalized on that in many videos, so I think it just took off from there.
That's what I'm saying, you know, because Bush Radio, nobody actually knew about it, especially like the community, maybe like small community people.
Yes.
The first time when me and Theodore went to come and visit you guys, when you interviewed us on Bush Radio, I didn't know. I was like, hey.
Wat is dat?
Bush Radio, wat is dat?
Ja.
We hebben ons een van de Afrikaanse goed wat het is. I think Theo told me about it, so because he was now heavy into Afrikaans as well at the time. So I was like, okay. But when we got there, I mean, just the amount of energy that you introduced us before we even got on air told me already about your personality. And that's just something that I always look back into whenever I see you do some stuff on social media. I know where it comes from because I saw it before.
The energy.
And it was always like, yeah, I don't know, bro, I want to know this guy's journey from that time when he interviewed people like that on radio. And now look at him. Now people want to interview him. You know, so it's a whole flip. Mm. You get what I'm saying? So to go back, I think for me personally, and it's my opinion, and anyone else can disagree with it, it's fine. I think you have worked and put Bush Radio on the map today because everybody tunes in. Like a lot of people that I know from a ghetto, they tune in and they prefer to listen because they know what they're gonna get from you. It's that Malgier.
It's a Malgier,
it's like, you know, you come in, you speak Afrikaans and you flip it again, you
English,
know what I mean?
Yeah, and for me that was a thing, man, because I think I also grew up listening to radio.
Yeah.
And I always remember listening to radio, but like, yes, what the people were telling me on the radio was cool and whatever, but it never appealed to me or where I was from.
Yeah.
And I mean I didn't just love in the ghetto. I loved all around, I loved in the suburbs, I loved in the ghetto. I moved maybe 14 times. I think I've said this in a few of my interviews. 14 times it was oral. So I mean the thing was that I wanted something where I know my brasser of the means where Ekman brasses could also feel that kind of energy on the radio. And again, it wasn't really done before or to such an extent where people were all like hovering around to actually listen to the radio.
Yeah.
So when I came in, I said, yes, we are more as I'm all duidelijk vandaag. I'm thinking about it, sending shockwaves right through South Africa. And I said, well, do you want to be ready? Because they expected, hi, good morning, Cape Town. Welcome to Bush Radio 9.5.
Yeah.
My name's Mr. Meyer. We're going to take you guys on a journey. I said, Ons het tyger luister wat die afgelope 20, 30 jaar. Ons is meer van kram. Hy praat soos is.
And I think, see, that's what I'm saying, man. You have just brought it at a whole different level.
Yeah.
And that's why I say you went and dig for people that's sitting there, maybe in 12 the line. He's saying, hi, fuck, man, I don't want to listen to whoever speaking today.
Yeah.
You know, get what I'm saying? And I think also the different personalities that you sometimes put on, that's more f***ing entertainment for me. I love that, me bro.
No characters.
I can see, oh, nah, man, die bra kan net super uit. Nah, you can flip the script as well. You know, and that's what I really dig that about you. And I think that's what made me more attractive to look at you. Especially on your gram. So, one thing that I need to ask you, and I think a lot of viewers or listeners might want to know this as well, if it didn't happen before, your locks.
Yeah.
You had
the locks, the dreads.
You had locks before.
Yeah.
So, tell me what you've done it with it, first of all.
What if I can't? Nah, I don't need to cash with
it. So you still have it. You still have it. You still have it. Okay, okay.
Because I love to cook it and lots of people want to buy it. Because everyone's like, Mr. Meyer, please, for cookie, I have a cookie, but I can't do it. I have a cookie.
Yeah?
Nasty, see, look, I have a cookie. I said, I get dreads for you.
But
I kept the dreads, you know. I decided, no, I left it in a nice old container, wrapped it up nicely, and it's still there. You know, even because I always thought at the time, but as it knows, smuggle via interest. I can't, it's my fault. And people don't understand that with dreadlocks, you just grow a little more, you can check in on your dreads.
Like with glue of it,
they what's your name? They crochet your hair into your original hair and it will just start growing like normal. Your hair is only fuse and it's not going to grow. So, what the
fuck? Sorry.
No, but you can do that. That's why I kept it. But I still have the dreads at home.
Yo, guy. Okay, okay. Yeah. So, what actually, why did you cut it? What is the decision? What look? Because that, I think it was also like your persona.
Yeah. Now, you see, so when I was in high school, it was by Belgravia in Italy. Yeah. So it was very really like growing. I mean, the school was like, I made new friends. It was just a good time growing up. But they, you know, back in the, you know, the old school system, I don't know how it is today, but you can't have long hair. You always have to be short. So I'm like, so even doesn't matter what your culture was, doesn't matter what you believed in. Say, no, it was Rasta, so what they do. They said, no, sir, you need to cut this hair. So for me, it has always been like, that thing that I just always wanted to do but never got around to doing it.
Yeah.
So I was in high school, I had dreads.
Yeah, yeah.
I said, nah, the rest is like, I'm licking the way. You can't swing, man.
And the type of respect you got. So
I think eventually I got to a point that I was like, you know what? I'm going to do it now. I don't care what anyone says. I don't care how anyone feels about it. If that's the opinion, that's fine. But I'm going to grow this hair. And I grew the hair for about four to five years. Grew quite long, but then also what I also told myself near the end when I cut it, I experienced the whole journey with it. I got everything I wanted out of what that, but it wasn't something, and I'm a chop and change man, so it wasn't something I was gonna, this is gonna be the image for the rest of my life until I die. It was something, I came there, I did it, I saw what it's about, I got what I wanted, right, I'm gonna keep moving, now we need to on to the next one. And I think that's also the mindset you should have just about industry, life, videos, you're doing is that you can never, you can't be doing the same thing.
You know,
expect something new to happen.
Oh, yeah.
So you, I mean, it's always about just finding something new. So I did the dreads. The dreads was lekker.
So, but you mustn't forget, you're sitting actually in a gold mine there with the dreads. Because a lot of people actually they buy it, they sold it for like a lot of money, me bro.
Yeah, nah, I got it. It's an investment, so some people do Bitcoin, I do dreads.
So roughly, if you had to sell your dreads today, like today, roughly, easy number come up your head, say it.
100,000 for yellow. But you know what, if I keep them, they're gonna mature a little, you understand? I know for a fact that you and I both, we're gonna have more famous, more mensen gaan ons kennen worldwide, globally. It's gonna be worth more. So it's investment.
That's yeah.
Dan kan het
true. So misschien for another 5 years.
Nog een 5 jaar, dan verkopen ze. Misschien, want hij is een miljoen.
Like it. And also what you said, Nami, bro, I don't think I'm gonna be famous because I move away from that stuff, you know what I mean? But respect for that, thank you for that, me bro. So we actually have the whole thing started of becoming a powerful influencer that you are today, me bro. What ignite that thought of like, nah, you know what, I can actually sell products, I can sell ideas, I can sell myself.
Yeah.
Where and what have started it? Because if I'm standing to be corrected, you and your sister, I think your sister was more in that type of limelight.
Yes.
Because she was very popular. I remember seeing some stuff. And Majestic. I didn't know. I only found it,
my sister, Majestic Mike.
I found it only afterwards that it's your sister, though.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my gosh, okay. So it must be in the blood. It must be in the family.
Yeah.
So why? If you guys never thought of starting something, or did your idea came from that,
or did you prefer to go your own solo way?
Look, I'm gonna take you back here. So firstly, I have to credit my sister for being one of the first person to have ever recorded a video of me and posted to social media.
Yeah.
Had it not been for her posting that one video she did of me in 2013, I don't think the whole journey would have even started at all when it comes to social media.
So shout out to your sister.
So shout out to Majestic Mate. The video was called Aquila's Well Purpose. We dropped that video in 2013. That was the first video I ever dropped. It had 500,000 views in 2013. Before Facebook algorithms were throwing out ads and things like that and changing how much people can view your... You know, it's the same like, it's like basically Facebook had the golden days where it wasn't about ads or paid posts.
Yeah.
If you posted something, everyone on your list was going to see it regardless and they could share it. This is before videos were being posted, so we posted videos in 2013 and those videos created huge traction because everyone could just see it at the time. So of course later Facebook now changed all these things now where it's a little bit harder for you to go viral, but we still managed to push through. But I want to say I'll shout out to my sister for doing that. I mean that was huge, and then from there we continued, and I don't know, after that one video demanded and no videos for me it was just a really good videos. And for me, it was never about like fame or anything. I come from house. I also want to give a shout out to my dad, Mr. Mani. As I think I can ook stroon praat. That is the king of that. That is if you meet him, you'll know where I got it from. So I think we grew up in a household where it was always very light-hearted, very funny. Lots of jokes in the house. My dad's friends, Bryce, you know, and all just chilling porches. And there's lots of jokes. And I think lots of that kind of folded into me as a youngster growing up around this. And also, again, my parents thought it was going to be very confident. Like, never worry what other people have to say about you. I think my mother always said, if they don't find you, if they don't find you, feed you off you, you don't give up what they say. You understand? Yeah. I know we grew up around that kind of mentality, so it was like, I'm gonna go get it with I like it. And so then now you're going back to me and my sister. We did do a few things. We did something called Maya Mondays for a while. We actually have something in the pipeline that we're going to do. However, the journey just kind of changed a little bit when she got married, man. You understand? She got married, she got the kid. So the thing is, we as siblings still want to connect and do our things as much, but now I think she had other priorities for herself in terms of her family. Now she has to now navigate her life. Okay. And then for me, I was like, look, I'm still doing my thing and I'm still on the roll. So it was never about like, it was just distance. It was like, because I think for one time she started doing videos with her husband, which was cool because I like that, the whole family video.
Family vibe,
and I'm still doing it now.
Is it?
Still not. You should go on Instagram. She's still popping, bro.
Okay.
Still popping, doing a lot of stuff. But I think she's put most of her attention on our niece, which is our baby, Kuro. Which is getting most of the attention. She's the young fashionista to come up now. But it's definitely, don't ever get it twisted. There's more things coming, bro.
Like,
we're not done. 2020, I'm about to live to 2100, bro.
Okay, so it's actually your sister that actually put you on the map.
I'm going to say yes.
To say, you know what, people actually want more. So she's the other.
She's the one. And she's my younger sister.
No, I remember she was popping at the time. I loved her videos.
Yeah.
So, okay. So now at least now I know where it come from.
Yeah.
And also, my bro, talk to me about your journey with, you and the youngster.
Yeah.
You guys know each other probably like...
quite long time. So I think since we were, 16
years
old. 16 years old.
Oh, and, okay.
Look, we're both 28 now.
Yeah.
So from 16 years
so
old.
So you guys actually started out before anything else, you was in the music and all of that stuff, and you guys were supportive of each other, right?
Yes, 100%.
Because I was like, yo, this relationship between you guys, it can't be like a thing because now you are known and he's known.
He's known.
Something that was born that time.
Ben Tays, yeah.
Yo, my bro, so where do you guys grow up in the same town?
No, Stuk, I grew up in Athlone. I was living in Crawford at the time in Athlone. Yeah. And they were living out in Wynberg. Mm. But we had a common friend. You see, I went to school with the Muffin Man.
Muffin Man.
Me and Muffy went to school. Brandon Court, we went to school together. I was actually one of these first rappers.
Okay.
At the time, so we did a mix.
You were rap before?
Yes, bro.
Hey, Mr. Meyer, rap, man. Hey, yes. Mr. Meyer, he rap, baba. We want a verse today.
Look, so we did our first mixtape in 2007. The mixtape was cool. But look, this was in a time when we were doing music at high school. It was in a time where it was almost like unbelievable for you to become like a famous rapper, and I'm talking about like on a global.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I know, I mean, we give props to, you know, Brasovanika, we give props to Prophets of the City, Mr. Devious, all of those kids were doing. But for us, like, in our minds, it's like, we wanted to be like Tupac or Biggie. You know what I mean? I want to be global.
Ooh. Yeah.
And I was like, were we ever gonna reach that kind of level of superstardom? And we were doing hip hop that time and time. And I think everyone was just like, nah, bro, this thing's not going anywhere.
Oh, yeah.
I actually had a chick at the time, and then she was like, you know, I know you love doing the hip hop, but you know, is it really going anywhere? Mm. And you know, at the time, Javi just in love, just say, okay, fine, I say, dung, I can't give it. I'm a king, I can't give it. But yet, I was still very passionate because I was, again, I've always been passionate about politics, yeah. Always been passionate about the streets, always been passionate about
weird, eh?
What's happening in and around. But I mean, I still have the raps, they are still. In fact, I have a tape that's busy with right now, but again, that's not the main forte I'm pushing.
Yeah,
I'm
not
pushing music, I can't still do music.
Yes.
Well, myself and Young, so we met in Panathia State in the, actually we met before that at clubs and things like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Back in the days, and then.
So that's a mutual thing.
It was a mutual thing, and then I think we have lots of mutual friends as well, and then we kind of connected through that. Muffin, we came to his house, we chilled there, and this is where everybody was, and this was around the time where the first Youngster tracks was ever coming out.
Like
stuff that no one had heard of him before. And this time we were still doing events at Turfle Primary, Athlone. They were doing CD launches. I mean the early days, I'm talking about back when we were 16, 17, we had literally like 10 people still get at the event. And for me, and then I was with them on the cards when he opened up for Lil Wayne, when he turned 19 years old, we were all there. The YMC and everything, and that was a good time. He opened up for Lil Wayne when he was 19.
Oh my word.
That happened at the Bellevue Velodrome, so we were all there for that. So it was nice to be part of the whole journey because I know where it all started for him and for IMU.
Yeah.
It really started from night, no one believed in this.
Oh wait.
I think it was near the time he dropped Salutas, and I was telling, and I was also getting to the radio time, and I told him,
"No,
we've come such a long way. You know, it's been 10 years, my bro. And I think we need to start taking ownership of who we are.
That's something that has never been done.
Because all this time, people want to try to act white, or people want to try to act, start speaking the way they weren't the racist people. And I told him, bro, I've done it for a long time, and how can I be that? Inspiration for the lighties.
I'm still trying
to be someone else.
Yeah.
And then I think we both kind of synchronized that mindset. We were at the same point in that we were like, you know what, bro? We're both gonna just go at it and just keep it real and caps up. And again, when we started, lots of people frowned upon it, like, how can you talk like it?
The
reason you're getting upset because you know exactly what we're saying.
Yeah.
And it took a few years of just going through the people's commentary, DJ, and die. And now, look, man, it's 2020 and the world loves
Cape
what
Town.
We're doing, you know?
No way.
Because we started to take pride in our own heritage, pride in our own culture, pride in who we are, and start telling our stories that we've never told before.
No way.
You know, because, I mean, maybe the history books say something different, but we must know how. I don't want to get super political, but I'm saying at least we understand that our culture has been frowned upon by so many other races or things like that.
Yeah, but the thing is, you know, I think it started with our people south because we never believed it to take it that far.
Yeah.
Because we always thought like, oh, you know what, we are too harsh, we are too muskoof.
Yeah.
We are too, our culture is maybe just about gangsterism and you get what I'm saying. But it's actually a deeper root than that, you know what I mean? And I think with a journey where everything has started about Cape Town, a lot of people, and I'm saying a lot of people, and I'm talking about internationally, they look into Cape Town culture now. And we don't even know about it. People looking at investing into our culture because they see the same thing that happens here, it's the same what happens overseas. Like, we are not different from what anything else happening over that side. We have the crime here, we have the crucial parties here, we have the gangsterism, we have actually very good attraction of tourism here. You know what I mean?
Which this is a beautiful city, is that what you want? This is one of the.
But people just look at the gangsterism part of it, you know what I mean?
Look, I don't want to be that guy, you know, who starts to go like to become, I'm going to say, conspiracy theorists and all that kind of things. But at the end of the day, we also understand what the narratives are for lots of the movies. And when you see colored people in movies, the narrative is always the same.
Just do
that. You know, when people are dying in the ghettos, I think these are the things that you're always going to see in The Voice, you're going to see on The August. You know, there's a shooting here, but imagine the media screens blocking out all the positive things all the time. What are you going to believe in any case? You've been, every day it's you've been bombarded with us, murders, violence. What if they told you, listen here, you know, Maurice's son just passed his, you know, passed his grade 3 and he's now on becoming one of a new scientist. The young man from Kaila, who no one believed him, started his own business. These stories are this small. Never make it in front page. All you want to hear about, you know, as much as if it bleeds, it leads. We know news. I did journalism. It's always going to be about the brava, the skitters, the kings. So now the narrative has always been that.
You know what, and it's if I have to just say one more time, but one last time about something about that. The thing is about it, you know, I say there's a good and a bad in that. Mm. Because they used whatever was happening in Cape Town to actually put us on the map.
Yeah.
And which was the crime, crime issue. And now that we are how many decades into it now, you get what I'm saying? I think they can change it. And we are the ones that actually are.
And they have to change the narrative, 100%.
And salute, I'm giving a shout out to Ephraim Gordon. He's busy with the movie right now that's completely taking a different route with Cape Town culture.
Yes.
And it's called Barakat.
Barakat, yeah.
So shout out to you, my own boy. We're looking forward to that movie later this year or maybe next year. But yeah, you know, and I think this is where all of that stuff happens. You get what I'm saying? We need to take the initiative to start actually a different route now.
Yeah.
Because enough is enough. We have seen what gangsters have done in Cape Town. Yeah. We have seen how they took over, you know what I mean? Now it's a beautiful part. Now it's the stuff that we are creative part.
Creatives, yeah.
We are so funny, bro.
Yeah, like, bro.
I mean, okay, you know, what's the MR.MEYER is the fucking most funniest guy ever in Cape Town. How many people are you, like, you are out there? You get what I'm saying? How many contents is there that we can produce out of Cape Town?
Out of Cape Town, yeah.
Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, and I think, you know, guys, with your relationship with your youngster, you have something that I think can develop into something beautiful because he's got a platform internationally now that can go that way. Do you get what I'm saying? Although he's with the music and you with the comedian side of things, you know what I mean? But I'm sure there's ways that you guys can work something out.
I guess it's always going to be more stuff for all of us. And I think, again, also, but respectively, throughout the discussions was that, you know what? It will always come back home. So for now, he's going to focus on doing the best version of me. I'm going to become the best version of myself.
Exactly.
And I think both pioneering our own, let's say, ways to the top. And then when the time is right.
The time is right.
Then more things will come thereof. But yeah, for now, I guess I'm still pushing.
Oh, yeah, my bro. And how did you say he opened for Little Wayne when you were 16?
19 years old, yeah.
You know, a lot of people don't know this about me as well. I actually opened for Bow Wow in 20... He was because at the time when I also took my music kind of serious, because I was mostly those into that gang.
Yes, indeed.
Time. And then I don't know, the owner of the club, it was in Somerset. The owner of the club, he contacted me and said, but he brought Bow Wow down. I can't remember what exactly the year that was. And it's like, okay, well, you know what? Man, I'm gonna take this opportunity.
Might as well, bro. Jump on the stage, bro.
Sounds like a bow wow, because it's all bad chest. Because at the time, I was fit, you know what I mean? I had a nice body, and he was always doing his thing. So he kind of challenged me on stage to take off the shirt, man, bro. I was a dire dignity.
You were still hot at the time as well.
And I mean, I was 12 years, 11 years on Isidingo. That was like, I think like six, seven years ago.
Yeah.
If I can remember.
It's been that long.
Yeah, my bro. So I gave it a shot.
Just props to you also, my bro.
Likewise,
I mean, I've been watching you since day one, bro. You go over Calvin Parker in your ammo.
Yeah. Give a shout out to Isidingo. They gave me a massive platform, actually. You know what I mean? They planted a root in me that I think I can sit down today.
Yeah.
And work with these guys and work in the way I am today, you know what I mean? And it's people like you that inspires me, man. You know what I mean? When I see you guys doing stuff on social media, and I'm not gonna lie, I get somehow my content from the funny things that you guys do and stuff, because I work on that stuff, you know.
They say everything is a remix.
Everything's a remix,
you know. Something must have come with somewhere. There's nothing new, you know. But I think what a very important part is, there's always gonna be a different twist on how you push things out.
That's why I say I always look around me, bro. I do my research on the internet for what people say and do. I learn from that because I move into a different direction, like behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Because I'm, behind the camera, it's not really my thing. You know, I don't have the features.
Nah, it's a YouTube approach.
Hey! But, my bro, to come back to this thing. Now, let's say, I don't know how many people has got to the wrong side of you, of Mr. Yeah. Mayana. Because, I mean, as you know, there's always a plus and a minus of things.
Yeah.
A lot of people say that you've got a dirty mouth. Like, you say things as it is. Like, you must say master goedes.
Yeah.
Right? And some of the people, they don't really agree with it all the time because it's like a sensitive thing for them. They think like, why should he be like that?
Yeah.
Does he talk like it? Is it just to get attention, all of that things, you know? But how was it at first when you had to deal with that situation?
Look, in the beginning, people also don't understand because I think I've told this time and time again, you know, like, I think I'm well educated enough to know that, you know, swearing is a crutch for conversational cripples. And for me, I don't use it for that. I don't use it for that reason. I think where I grew up, where I was raised, right? When I lived in Mitchell's Plain, when I lived in Athlone, for us, you know, I know for the older generation, it's always gonna be like that taboo thing, because I think if you're a religious person, if you're holy, and if you believe in your faith very strongly, it's kind of taboo to swear because it's like it's somewhat frowned upon, you know what I mean? And also for young kids to listen to that, it's odd. But again, I was gonna be the first of my kind of friends and the places where I was from to express ourselves. The thing is, maybe if you live in the ghetto, you might not be a gangster, but you to prati mensa. You come from this area, you might not be like everyone there, but you understand how the people react to certain things. I can say, you know guys, it's like your mother tell you, take your feet off the table. This is fucking your f***ing foot off of the table. No will say luister. So you see now, no will say luister. Ik ben nou eerst de vloek. So even lots of the people, the funny thing is that most of the people that were upset with is this is how they speak behind closed doors. This is what they know, understand. And it was all, and for me, I hated the fact of having to put a face on for other people all the time, because all the time you have to act like a certain way. It's the same like, you know, like getting that call from the directors and now you at home and your brother says, my brother's going to go as I mentioned, oof, how is that call from I mentioned? Hello, Mr. Johnson. No, perfect. I will be available Monday. That sounds perfect. Phone down. Yo, massa, you did talk a clear, didn't you? Understand? So I wanted us to stop hiding behind that person that you have to know. You know, the white people in voice and things like that. I was like, you know what? This is who we are. And I'm going to speak on it. Not everyone speaks like this. I understand that. For some people, it's going to be vulgar. But you love a standy, man. When you say you love a standy,
like you don't know where it comes from.
Yeah, you don't know where it comes from. And then again, if I look in the grander scheme of things, you know, again, swear words again, I mean, as my yellow maar die kracht voor die woorden gegeven.
Exactly.
At the end of the day, you know what I mean? So I mean, I know what it means, but it's powerful enough to get what's the emotion out of you.
Exactly,
So then it must be working. Yeah. You know? It must be stirring up some
part. At least I always say, it doesn't matter. And if something gets to you and it bothers you, and you take it further, then you're actually making me bigger. You know what I'm saying? You don't know about it, because sometimes it's so stupid and it's like you don't even have to think about it, you don't have to make a big deal out of it, but you want to take it further.
You want to take it further. And that's what I was telling people. The thing is, like, look here, if you don't like meat, if you're a vegetarian, what's your journey butcher? A tiny fan soccer balls, what's your
beef? Yeah, beef.
So now, that's what I tell people about me in the beginning. It's like, if you don't like me, you don't like the things I say, I'm not forcing you to watch me, I'm not forcing you to come see what I'm doing. So if you have an opinion, why come watch something you don't like and have an opinion on it? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because the thing is, if the 100 people don't like what I'm doing, I know the other 100,000 do. So I'm going to focus on the 100,000.
Exactly, yeah.
So, I mean, the thing is, you'll never be able to make everyone happy. You can offer the whole world gold bars, still some will be complaining they want silver.
Exactly. Well, there you have it, guys. Yeah. You know, this guy is never going to stop swearing. He's never going to stop saying what he does. Because it's a natural thing. Yeah. Ken het, jylle weet het, so meneer nog kom, Guala, en jylle sal sê. Ja, broers, kijk jy nou, so what's next for Mr. Meyer?
What's next? Look,
what's next? Like the biggest thing, I think.
I think it's amplifying the platforms I'm on, but I think a very big thing for myself is also to go into a more of a managerial role or director role for other youngsters to do things. I'm still young, I'm still doing my thing. I still have lots of years in me, you know, God willingly, to do many things. But I don't also want to be the forefront of what I'm pushing for the long term. I want young blood to come in. I think we never got the opportunity for someone to say, you know what, bro? There's youngsters who also want to get into this thing, is to pass the torch, and I want to be one of the few people that's going to pass the torch. Like, you know what, if I want to teach other young kids how to do radio presenting, how to get into social media. Cool. So I'm thinking of doing like somewhat of classes, getting some kids, going to the communities, getting young people involved in this. You know, if let's say in 5 years or 10 years from now, I'm not going to be the guy on Bush Radio, but I want someone who's a protege of mine to be that guy over there. Yeah. You know, I can't... at some point, we all have to say goodbye to the limelight. And I don't mind, provided that I have more youngsters following that same let's say, narrative and mindset or ethos that I had while doing it, but still giving being a somewhat of a mentor for them. But don't worry, it's still lots for me. Moet nie worry. For me, I got to create movies, I got books skryf, I got clear and mark. I'm gonna travel, I'm gonna tour, I'm gonna host, I'm doing school tours, I'm doing shows. It's not gonna stop, you know what I mean? You know, I believe that you'll never lose with God on your side, and I'm a man, I'm a man of faith.
That's good.
God is with me all the time.
We meet each other again.
100%.
Movies, bro.
Yeah.
That's where my focus is also at, and I think for doing this is to find out where our people are really are, because we busy with a lot of things. You know, we as Moja Media, we do a lot of things. I come in with directing skills with mine for the creative side of things. So we are actually working on a whole lot of things to take it further, because I know this is not where I want to be in front of the camera.
It's not.
I don't know, it's something that I believe I was never meant to be in front of a camera. I'm behind the camera.
Behind the camera.
My creative eye is much better.
Mm.
Yeah, so I will definitely keep you in mind for whatever movies.
Call me, bro. I'm there, bro.
Because, I mean, you know, your personality is something that I know
is
going to need to be out there, especially what kind of character. If I have to put you in a character, how you will do, what you will do with it.
Yeah.
You know, that's good. That's going to be quite interesting for me to see. And to think about it. Acting. But think about it. If anyone like no soapy, like maybe one of these Afrikaans things, you know, that it's out today, CakeNet, or maybe SABC thought about putting you into a series or soap.
I got actually calls for a couple of short films that I was meant to do.
Short films.
I was meant to do as well last year, and then also doing some appearances here and there. But I think this is the year of fruition for all of that things to actually happen.
Yeah.
No, because I definitely see myself. That's gonna be like second nature for me to be on set, to be doing that stuff. But again, same like you said also as well. I also don't also want that to be the be all and end all, because Tom Cruise will not be young forever, you know what I mean? But Steven Spielberg will be rich forever. You understand? And again, it's not also just about the money. I think also as people who come from different communities and things like that, we also have an idea of
where
you want to be, and also the type of vision that you want to be seen, be caught on camera. Take Ken Mosey's shots, how this thing needs to look. You also a storyteller. And in order for you to tell the story, sometimes you don't actually have to be the story.
Exactly.
It's fine for you to tell the story from the back, even through visually and creative. So I guess I want to, at some point, I want to definitely be in movies, definitely want to be into series. But at the later stage, when I'm seasoned in what I do, is also to take a role of where, like, now it's like for the other people and for me to tell stories through them and give them opportunities, which is the idea.
You know where I see it, like with the way and the rate that you are moving now, I almost see you within the next 10 years, a biography of Mr. Meyer. Because remember the name Mr. Meyer of Cape Town? That rings a bell to everyone. I think there's not a person in Cape Town that doesn't know that name.
Mr. Meyer.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The mayor of Cape Town itself. And I think it sounds like a, and I'm saying this in 2020, within the next 10 years, if I'm still alive, God's willing, I think there's going to be a biography about Mr. Meyer. I think there should be.
You think should be?
And if we put it in the universe.
And
maybe in the next 5 years, if I won't be the instigator, someone was going to do it.
Yeah.
Because I think it's something, you're doing such powerful work for Cape Town, Mekuru, that I think just because of your authenticness, you know, people can relate to whatever you say, how you do it, and where you do it, like the type of locations you go to and do your funny shit. You know, that's, I mean, you know what I mean? Who would think that, you know, you know what I'm saying? And people will look at it, I mean, and say, yarr. Tijdelijk moest dus mijn auntie zei is daar jong of mijn broer was daar niet bij Bob's way af en hij.
Maar goed,
is daar en zei, it's stuff like that when you hear, it's like people can relate to stuff that they see on TV. They can see it on social media with you.
Yeah.
In Cape Town.
100%.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I think it's a path and it's a way that I think within 10 years time, with whatever content you're still gonna come up with, that you're gonna establish your name even bigger than what it is now. I think it's definitely worth of being
appreciate it, bro.
For real. So I would say best of luck with you and your career, my bro.
Thank you, bro.
I always watch your stuff, and there's a lot of people that you know do watch your thing, but I think I'm paying more close attention.
There's more coming, bro. I'll have to see. I've got a video where they can join me. Shubhavadak. Shubhavadak. Who knows?
We're that worthy. Let's see how many man, my bro. very pale to pick. Yeah. I mean, who don't want to be with this guy, huh?
Yeah.
But yeah, from my side, my bro, thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure, my bro.
For making the sacrifice to come out here, to be on time, and to come and sit down and talk to me. I mean, yeah. I would have never heard this stuff from you. I mean, we always see each other on the social platforms.
On social platforms, events and so. Like,
yeah, you know what I mean? There's never time to sit down
just
and talk.
Connect,
so I appreciate this time.
I appreciate it as well, man.
Really, really. And I think for the future, there's definitely some work that me and you have to do.
We will.
And I stress that have to do. You get what I'm saying? Because I think I feel your realness.
Yeah.
And that's the important thing about me. When you sit down with people, not just, I mean, you're my second person now, but just in general, you know, like, you know.
Energies don't lie, man.
Energies never lie. You know me, bro. You know how it is. So there's definitely some big ideas that I'm going to come up with.
Yeah.
That I know that I can work with you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? From my side. And this is not something that I'm just going to say now today.
Yeah, I don't want to start. She's like, I said, if I need pay, it's a big up.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Not that it's going to be much bigger than what you are already.
No, look, I'm just happy for, like, I mean, again,
this work.
For those connections and things like that. And I feel even for lots of even Cape Townians and even South Africans in general who are just doing stuff. Collaboration has always been a nice thing, you know, for some people. Yeah. And I mean, working with many different people, it also opens up more avenues for you to see how things are done and things like that. I'm just not just talking about you and I, but just mean I've collaborated with so many social media people on the up and up, you know, and it's nice to see that I've even given many people platforms just to do their thing as well. And for me, it's always been about that for more people just to also do it and for their dreams to come into fruition. And if we could take it to the next level together, Why not?
So before we go,
Bro.
Before we go, we gotta take Mr. Meyer back to his rap days.
Oh shit! He can't even hear rap. I don't rap anymore.
We gotta hear maybe one or two. Just a verse. We wanna hear.
Can next verse, you remember?
Ooh, maybe you gotta make something up. Maybe there's a mic.
Nah, but then there's a next beat. Give me
maybe
a beat.
The bling bling.
Give me a beat. 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 So I'm lamin in the studio, feeling like I'm cool, yo. Sitting right back when I'm lamin in my. I'm not fucking money. Why beat? I'm making a lick.
Okay, let me.
A lick a boom, baby, I'm sure, man.
Okay.
Yeah. So while I'm with my boss, every single day, trying to get the screw in like every single way. Lamin on the block, so I'm lamin with my boss, lamin with the tennis, and then lamin with the boss. Lamin like easy, smoking on the cheesy, trying to buff a drink, and I must always think, when I wanna see you, why you wanna chunk? Lamin with your boss, the karuk on the skunk. Lamin in the studio, me and Maurice, coming through easy, never been greasy, never smoked cheesy, but lamin so easy, always feeling liquor, rubbing on your tether, looking at this girl, and she's getting better. I know.
Whoa!
Sorry.
What I put him on the spot, and he did it. He did it. And now you know. This guy is for real. Wow, this is me, my show again. My second time. So I will say thank you very much. I'll see you guys next time. Keep it up. Move!